find ways of responding to state violence and the slow drag of urban poverty and racial tensions eating away at the Southland of the 1990s. But Professor Alexander posed a question that day that bravely modeled a new way for the academic who also desires to be an artist, who also desires to be an activist, to respond to the complexities of late 20th century racial catastrophes as they were and still are unfolding at the intersections of cultural representations, new technologies, and racial and gender and class-based power structures. "Can you be black and look at this?" she asked in the title of her now classic essay. It was a challenge to go deeper as scholars, to ask different kinds of questions of archives, to think expansively, write boldly, creatively, dangerously, to invoke one of our past Morrison lecture speakers, Edwidge Nanticott, to find ways to make what we were doing in our research and in our teaching actively count, move, contest, break free of rigidity. It was an invitation to take our knowledge as academics and speak the unspeakable histories of our everyday lives that Professor Morrison had been calling upon us to do as well for so many years. It forever changed me as a scholar, gave me a new critical lexicon for articulating the cultural memory in the flesh, as Professor Alexander would call it, that sits at the foundation of the Black freedom struggle and the Black studies scholarly arm of that struggle as well. That day, her reputation preceded her, for we in the audience were already well aware of this stunning young poet, author of rich, roving verse, at once historically thick and yet beautifully angular, surprising, elusive, sensual, philosophically rigorous, fearlessly intimate and playful, potent and propulsive, musical and spiritual, as cosmically wondrous as Phyllis, as slyly vernacular as Langston, as radiant and righteous as Gwendolyn, as rhythmically radical as Sonia, as gracefully porous as Lucille's language. Her poetry hails, questions, and encapsulates our lyrical history, a combination of the brutally harrowing and the infinitely majestic, while also stretching us towards the tomorrow of the very Morrisonian what might be. She is the daring archivist who returns us to us a Sarah Bartman of complex privacy, fierce subterfuge, and flexible tongue. She is the bold historian who takes us to the after and the space at the end in the Amistad poems. She is the voice of jubilation and mischief who beckons us to revel in the sumptuousness of our childhood, glowing with 100 megawatts of butter. She is the figure in her Toni Morrison Dreams poem who listens to the one with the gorgeous pewter dreads extol love's wisdom, whispering it to the next generation. One of the most critically acclaimed poets and Black feminist scholars of her generation, Elizabeth Alexander, is the author of six books of poems, including American Sublime, a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize, and most recently, Crave Radiance, New and Selected Poems, 1999 to 2010, and winner of the 2010 Patterson Prize for Poetry. A trenchant cultural studies scholar, she is also the author of two books of essays, The Black Interior and Power and Possibility, in which she offers meditations on figures as diverse as Anna Julia Cooper, Romare Bearden, June Jordan, Bill T. Jones, Oprah, and yes, to everyone's delight, Denzel. In these elegantly cogent essays, she models for us the kind of fluidity as an artist and a critic who, like our own Professor Morrison, finds recourse in art and criticism and the joyously rebellious spaces in between each of these realms. Last two paragraphs. To most people around the world, she is, of course, best known for having delivered her quietly insurgent poem, Praise Song for the Day, at the inauguration of President Barack Obama on January 20th, 2009, the fourth poet in history to have ever done so. But in addition to that milestone, Professor Alexander has received numerous honors, too many to list here, but which include the Annis Feld Wolf Lifetime Achievement Award in Poetry, the Alphonse Fletcher Senior Fellowship, and the Jackson Poetry Prize. She's also, of course, the chair of the African American Studies Department at Yale University. Bright and early, at the crack of dawn one summer morning a couple of years ago, I was lucky enough to turn on my radio and hear a voice familiar to me say these words, "And children also are drawn toward language that shimmers, individual words with power. They will stop you and ask you to repeat a shimmering word if they're hearing it for the first time. You can see it in their faces." It was Elizabeth Alexander in the public radio program On Being, reminding us that, quote, "There is so much more to the word. The word is sober, the word is grave, the word is not just about something light and happy and pleasurable. The word calls out deep, deep responsibilities." Her luminous body of work remains both a celebration of the word and an adventurous call, a spiritual, ethical, and intellectual movement in letters that asks us to open ourselves up to each other, to and through the miraculous conundrums of language. For all of these reasons, she is a writer who remains an exhilarating affirmation of Toni Morrison's legacies. And so it's my great pleasure, my great honor, to have her here with us today to deliver the second of the Toni Morrison lectures. Please join me in welcoming the wondrous Professor Elizabeth Alexander.
Thank you. That is the most generous introduction I have ever had. Thank you very, very much. Okay. Yesterday at the lecture, I did all of my thank yous and talked about what it means to come here and to be with what I call my brothers and sisters in this ongoing conversation in African American studies that we're having all over the country and all around the world, and that provides so much nourishment and inspiration. So I won't go over it all today. Suffice it to say, I thanked everybody, and I'm very, very happy to be talking with you all again. Don't forget to feed the Loas, near ancestry and contemporary black art. This talk will focus on the work of the late Eritrean-American painter Fikre Gebreyesus and the painterly language of near ancestry in his and other black diaspora art. Developing Etheridge Knight's phrase, the idea of ancestry, and moving from yesterday's examples of Lucille Clifton and Bill T. Jones, I'm going to continue my discussion of art that speaks to intimate proximity to death and the ancestral imperative in black culture. Don't forget to feed the Loas serves as an entreaty or opening salvo for this work. The refrain from Ishmael Reed's great novel, Mumbo Jumbo, and that's where you've heard it before, don't forget to feed the Loas, articulates the imperative to remember to honor the deity-like ancestral forces that guide us through our contemporary lives. The offerings on their altars may be fruit or flowers, chicken or wine. When taken metaphorically, offerings may also be found in the form of art and the calling of names that honors our dead and keeps them near. Fikre Gebreyesus was my husband, and you will have to trust me when I take off my wife hat and put on my cultural critic hat for the rest of this talk to say that what you are about to see is a major body of mostly unknown work by a painter who makes an extremely significant contribution to contemporary art, simultaneously expanding the conversation about what is African art today and what is exciting in African American and American art. We just closed a show of his work in New Haven, curated by Kijo Lee, entitled Polychromasia, or The Condition of Being Multicolored, which expresses the ethics of color that drove his mature work. I will refer to him throughout my talk as Fikre, not because of my own intimacy with him, but rather because that is how he wished to be known. He signed the paintings, when he signed them, Fikre G. His full name, Fikre Mariam Gebreyesus, means lover of Mary, servant of Jesus, and in its shortened version, it means love, something that was neither lost on him in his day-to-day life. It is an apt artistic moniker for a person whose avid love ethic motivated him to pull in everything around to create a fresh and exciting visual perspective on the world. Fikre was born in Asmara, East Africa, Eritrea, was a refugee in Sudan, Italy, and Germany, and came to the States at the age of 19. He lived almost 30 years of his life in the perhaps unlikely place of New Haven, Connecticut. So he is resolutely an Eritrean artist, an East African artist, and an African artist. But at the same time, he was unambiguous about being a black Eritrean American and a black American. Before he came to this country, he was exposed to United States black power rhetorics. An early visual icon for him was Angela Davis's luminous afro. He painted it over and over and over again. And thinkers such as Martinican Frantz Fanon, black soul music from Sam Cooke to James Brown, fed into conversations in his head with Fela and Bob Marley. He was a global diasporist, in his words, a conscious syncretist, whose rich background enriches our understanding of what contemporary US blackness is all about. We're fortunate to have a statement from him that he wrote on the occasion of his application in 1999 to the Yale School of Art. I'll be reading bits and pieces of it interspersed with some of his early work, and will give you a sketch of some of his history in his own words. and there are motifs that will recur, of which I'll remind you as we move through the pictures. He wrote in 1999, quote, "I started painting 10 years ago, but I suspect I have been metaphorically doing so all my life. When I started painting, I just did it. I had never felt a stronger urge. The pieces that flowed out of me were very painful and direct. They had to do with the suffering, persecution, and subsequent psychological dilemmas I endured before and after becoming a young refugee from the Independence War, 1961 to 1991, in my natal home of Eritrea, East Africa. Painting was the miracle, the final act of defiance through which I exorcised the pain and reclaimed my sense of place, my moral compass, and my love for life. From Eritrea, I found myself in New York City, where my tiny kitchen table instantly became the studio table." These are some of the early paintings. These early paintings are mostly large, dark canvases lit with brilliant corners of insistent life. The paintings give a sense of his beloved homeland in wartime. The Eritrean Independence War began just before he was born. Infused with the light of determined humanity that would not be deferred or extinguished. There were line cuts and monoprints in these early groupings of work that he'd made at the printmaking workshop with Bob Blackburn, and paintings he'd made at the kitchen table and while studying with Joe Stapleton at the Art Students League. New York years when he was mostly working as a student leader and activist on behalf of Eritrean issues. Those are large paintings I've showed you, and this is a very, very small one. Asmara, and these are his words, is a beautiful city at 8,000 feet above sea level, planned and designed by Italian colonists at the turn of the century. In addition to the collision of architectures, iconographies, and propaganda art, there was the unique and palpable visual aesthetic of death. Soviet tanks rumbled through the streets, fighter planes strafed the skies, and deadly uniformed soldiers rummaged through the streets and homes. It was a medieval vision of hell incarnate. Government-sponsored death squads had powers of emergency over any Eritrean citizen. I suspect I have carried this angst and fear of imminent explosion within me to this day, for when I paint, I am accompanied by dissonances, syncopations, and the ultimate will for life and moral order of goodness. New York was a huge influence on him, as with so many artists before and after. Joe Stapleton was a connection both to abstract expressionism and the social realist history so prevalent at the Art Students League. Fikre also worked for a bit at the Senke Gallery, where, if he had not been exposed before, he would have become familiar with Hale Woodruff's work and the great tradition of Woodruff's peers such as Charles Alston and Romare Bearden. So these are some paintings from that period. And so as we move from this one, we're going to look at just a couple of the influences I just mentioned. Ben Shahn, Romare Bearden's Visitation, and Leon Golub. And this is where the work starts to undergo a really interesting transition, and you start to see a move away from a certain kind of empathetic social realism to work that begins to be more profoundly and fundamentally driven by color, and also work that is willing to abstract from its true commitment to the figure. And so, for example, and all of those were, he rode the subway like anyone else and did folks on the subway, but if you look at the movement from this painting to the next, now the subway car is red, of a different color. What's that little teeny tiny person doing over there? Things are starting to change, and I think that here in this painting, you really see the most powerful transitional moment where there's almost too much going on, but we see signs of everything that comes. We see his use of language in the paintings. There's a lot of etched words that are up there and figures. We see the more of the color drivenness that comes later. We see the air raid airplane that morphs into a bird of paradise. That's a recurrent figure. The horse figure returns over and over again. So kind of everything's happening here, but things are about to undergo a big change. And we're now in the middle 90s. We were in 1996. And we see then a period of brilliant abstraction that is concomitant with his work building Café Adulis, a a legendary restaurant that ran for 16 years in New Haven, where the food was based in Eritrean cuisines, but again, in Fikre's words, syncretic. He was living at the time at 218 State Street, the New Haven Cash Register Company building, in an unfinished loft where he slept and painted when he was not cooking his Eritrean fantasia food, legendary dishes such as shrimp barka that existed nowhere but in his own imagination. He used to chef through the evening, close down the restaurant, and then paint until dawn in that loft with its salvaged Steinway piano, clothing racks he'd rolled down the street from Macy's when it went out of business, and graffiti scrawled on the heavy metal door by a previous occupant that read, "Foster Kindness." In April of 1988, he and we moved to 45 Livingston Street, where he painted in a garage studio behind the house, and there his practice and colors changed dramatically, moving more fully into the abstracted space, figures, landscapes, and icons discernible, but not strictly representational. And here, this is an Ethiopian-American painter for comparison, Skunder Bogosian. And here are some of these further abstractions. The influence of the colors of his childhood are being referenced in this period, along with a muscular understanding of the power of abstraction, which reconciles later in further work. He wrote, "A trip to the market guaranteed a dazzling range of traditional crafts repeated from one generation to the next without ongoing critical intervention and independent of religious function. These crafts included a dazzling range of works such as reed baskets and hand-spun, hand-woven, embroidered cotton garments in exquisitely resolved colors. The caves near my mother's village are full of prehistoric rock drawings and paintings. My eyes took in all of this. My painting allowed me to finally process the seemingly dissonant visual information. The painter is an individual, however, without church or mosque affiliation and sanctioned by civilians and government, is a relatively new concept for us in Eritrea, 40 years old at most. When I paint in my studio in New Haven, some 5,000 miles from home, I still find myself reacting to this reality. My normative experience is inescapably Eritrean, and as it turned out for me, I also have to respond to and account for the stimuli and influencing forces that I found myself open or vulnerable to because of my life here. So far, I've been able to cull the various forces such as bebop, modern jazz, especially Thelonious Monk and Charles Mingus, polyrhythms of the African diaspora, and the great many paintings that I spend time viewing in museums when I can take time off." Okay, so now we go into a new period, and might not be able to see it at the bottom, but scratched into the paint in the bottom, it says, "I believe we are lost," and thus the title of the painting. When Fikre was a child, one of his nicknames was Mangialibro, book eater in Italian, and indeed his hungry lifelong love of reading is everywhere in his work. Connected to his love of books and his insatiable curiosity of mind was his relationship to languages. He spoke 7 living languages well, Tigrinya, Amharic, Italian, English, Arabic, German, and Spanish, could say hello and thank you in literally dozens of other languages. He said, what could be more important to know in a language besides thank you? And was teaching himself Mandarin and French. His language acquisition was an emblem of the politics of colonialism and exile. When he left Eritrea as a teenager in the midst of the Red Terror and Derg regime, his life as a refugee took him to Sudan, Italy, and Germany, as I've mentioned, and then the States. Eritrea was for some time an Italian colony. He received a beautiful early education from Italian nuns, and that was the language of extensive book study for him. Amharic was also a colonial tongue for a long, fraught period. Spanish came from long years of restaurant work, communicating intimately with the people he worked with in his kitchens. But his relationship to language also said everything about his respect for others, his sense of us all as connected global citizens, his belief in the idea of a lingua franca, and his constant curiosity to learn and then amalgamate different ways of thinking and being in the world. As others have noted, his paintings were very much about language and communication. There's so much language in them. And so I'll show you a few then from that grouping and period. And then again, for comparison, Hale Woodruff's Afro Emblems. And then these are some, is a very, very tiny little text poem painting, Langston Hughes's Minstrel Man. There are lots of these. This, with its lines from W.H. Auden's September 1, 1939, for the error bred in the bone of each woman and each man craves what it cannot have, not universal love, but to be loved alone. Your eyes were watching God. There's a keen sense of story and narrative in the work, and now we're going to move into a very mature sequence of quite large paintings. He's always working at different scales, and so these paintings actually are a little bit, about as big as you'll see them here. He wrote, and this about his sense of story and narrative. Storytelling comes naturally in Eastern Africa, where the mainstay of culture is orally transmitted from generation to generation. Many Eritreans are still illiterate, and the culture of visual communication is relegated to Coptic Orthodox church facades and interiors. Murals and mosaics of saints and angels abound. There is equally strong presence of Islamic iconography on the exteriors and interiors of mosques. Concomitant to these two ancient presences in my growing up years in the capital city of Asmara were wartime mural-sized portraits of Marx, Engels, Lenin, Stalin, and, depending if he was in favor, Chairman Mao, as well as the Ethiopian dictator, Colonel Mengistu Haile Mariam. Fikre's time in art school, and these are our paintings that are going to come afterwards, at the Yale School of Art, was a mixed bag. He was a grown-up, extremely open to learning as he always was, but not a malleable kid. He was a respected town professional, by that time a father of two. His particular African diaspora aesthetics were sometimes misread by teachers. One teacher said to him, "Where are the African colors in your paintings?" Which is to say they wanted like red, black, green, and gold paintings. And he was different from me, you know, because I might have responded one way, and he, you know, very beautifully talked about his mother's baskets and textiles. He gave the answer instead of, you know. but he had a good experience as a teaching assistant with Richard Lytle, strong, honest encouragement from Sam Messer. He loved outdoor painting excursions in New Haven's mixed metaphor landscape of New England trees and industrial detritus. He made some fascinating text-based conceptual pieces in class with Mel Bachner. Most important, however, were some artist visits he helped arrange with his classmates. A studio visit from the painter Amy Silman, whose use of color and commitment to abstraction spoke powerfully to Fikre. Having Adrian Piper and Martin Purger in his studio was a highlight of his time in graduate school. He brought them to campus. Their encouragement and enthusiasm carried him all the way through. He revered each artist as a true master. And though his work looked nothing like either one's, they asked him the deep questions that took his practice to the next level. It especially pleased him that Piper practiced yogic headstands during her visit in his studio, for he was beginning his own devoted and very influential to him yoga practice around that time. He was also very happy that Martin Purger instantly knew what his name meant from the time that Purger spent in his younger years working in Africa. He cared deeply that people come in peace, for he himself was a profoundly peaceful and peace-loving person, forged as he was in the crucible of war. So here, through these big, mature pieces, we also see a consistent West African syncretization, which I think is really, really interesting. So in this painting, Red Room, it of course alludes to Matisse's Red Room, which I'll show you in a minute, but also references this Yoruba figure that's in the Yale Art Gallery. And here is Matisse's Red Room, and another important painting to him, Matisse's Still Life. Matisse's The Joy of Life is something else to look at, to think about his figures. And now I'm just going to take you through a whole bunch of paintings and say a few things about each of them, because I've grouped them. So these are some smaller paintings that showed, and this is to give you a sense of all of the different modes of his work. His interest in architecture in landscape. This is referring to Lalibela, of course. These are some little New Haven paintings. And then here, a series of paintings where he explored the concept of horizon. And And here in this one, which is called Untitled with Interred Figures, you also see these etched figures in the bottom who appear and reappear in a number of paintings and were, as he talked about them, his Middle Passage figures that kept insisting and finding their way into the pictures in shadowy, ghostly ways, which speaks to my larger topic. And then a long series of very mysterious vessels. So sometimes there are, and this is again a little teeny tiny postcard painting made in Maine, done from, you know, life painting looking out. So there were some like that, but some that move in a curious abstracted direction. More of those little figures. And these in the Solitary Boat series, which culminate with this extraordinary painting, Solitary Boat in Red and Blue. His musical life was also crucial to his art. Polyrhythms provide a governing logic for his paintings. He played the Eritrean lyre-like instrument, the krar, and also practiced West African drumming and kept a djembe close at hand at home and in the studio. You never know when you need a djembe. He was studying the guitar. His musical tastes were extremely varied, knowledgeable, and esoteric. Everyone I know knows and loves music, and maybe Daphne had more CDs than he does, but I don't know. I mean, he had a wider ranging and more exhaustive and encyclopedic knowledge of music than anybody I ever met, which is saying something. And he loved the syncretism of music, to echo his word, of the Black diaspora, the complexity of polyrhythms. And so I think that what he learned from music very fundamentally and transferred to his painting was the way in which Black music's polyrhythms holds everything disparate together. The mystery of how all of these different strands can be held together, as well as the driving forward music movement of great Black music. Here, in a grouping, paintings that abstract on Coptic angels. And these also segue into and overlap with paintings of musicians. He also had an ongoing interest in portraiture. So you saw some of those earlier portraits in the New York years. And then in these later years, his portraits change. He's now also painting people who are either literally known to him or distilled from those known to him. Most of the faces are either distinctly Eritrean, and you do know it in the face. Sometimes they are his children, sometimes they're known relatives, sometimes his wife. He also sometimes painted himself, but we know about self-portraits less from how the figures looked and more from a gesture or an item of clothing. So for example, this was his favorite pink shirt. And here he was practicing the guitar with his pink shirt referenced in the pinks behind him. And I said, those are self-portraits. And he said, really? These paintings, these portraits, I think, are characterized by tremendous intimacy and depth and beauty. Another comparison, Emil Nolde. The last years of his life were radiantly productive. He worked every day in his double-width studio in Erector Square. He always had a large, wall-sized, unstretched mural, scrolls as he called them, in process. In those paintings especially, we could see the language logics that informed the work. He would toggle between several pieces of different scale at once, the epic, the medium scale, and then the beautiful little palm-sized canvas postcards. He was making photocollages of his pictures of coconuts, a longtime obsession. And in the restaurant, they served sorbet, and that came the little bindi sorbets in the coconut shell. And when I moved in with him, there were maybe 12 big industrial garbage bags. And I said, what's in these? And he said, it's the coconut shells. And he said, I'm going to make military helicopters out of them and do an installation about growing up in the Red Terror. And we took those coconut shells from place to place. And then later on, he became interested in coconuts by photographing them and made some quite amazing photo collages. And we continue to see the refiguring both of the colors of his childhood. He described his mother as a great colorist whose influence was felt in her choosing border colors for embroidery, vegetable dyes for baskets, and mixing the vibrantly hued dried ground spices that went into berbere, the local spice blend of which every respectable home had its own blend. And there also is the clear influence of the painter Bob Thompson. So this is Thompson. And these are some little Figre paintings. This I quite love, blue figure boat hat. And then these are, again, just I think some very important, mature, large paintings. This is Mangialibro. Again, these are as big as you see. This is 100 years. And you see the book over there, 100 Years of Solitude. Nude with Bottle Tree. And I told you about some of these Eritrean crafts. So these are some of the baskets. So you can see clearly the relationship. These are some of the baskets up close and the lattice work in the paintings. I think echoes this really importantly. And so this is one of his epic works and the most realized of the long scroll murals. So this goes, this next one, more than the length of what you see here. And this is called City with a River Running Through It. In this painting, in its sense of narrative, there's much learned from Bearden's The Block. Bearden was a painting who Figre revered. As I'm beginning to sort through some of the influences. And I think the driving exploded color sense that for Bearden comes most to life when he begins working in collage, the fearlessness with color that we see in Bearden's later watercolors and the blurred saturation in works like Maudel Sleet's Magic Garden, and the same profound sense of inside and outside that we see in The Block or in Mecklenburg County works like Electric Evening, when we see an inside scene but the outside beyond. Figre took lessons from all of that, and there's much more to say about this, but as you can see, I'm giving you a frustratingly swift survey. And then another recurrent motif in the painting is the gate, or the gate to the compound. So this painting is called Gate to the Blue, and this is Gate to the Compound. And here you can see the compound refers to his childhood home. And here the gate is open, and the soldiers have made their way inside against a fantasia of a moat, and we don't know what's going to happen. And this is a sort of a primal scene that he returns to over and over again, the violation of the compound that echoed with an extraordinary story that he told of his mother driving soldiers out of the house while all of the children hid in the bed through sheer force of person. And then here, in the very beautiful mural, Gate to the compound is intact. The compound is protected by a bottle tree, another West African borrowing. The compound is also protected by the suggestion of angel wings, if you look at those lines there. And the colors behind the compound, the felicitous colors behind the compound door, are the colors of his peaceful childhood. So this is Gate to the Compound. I pointed out some of those refigured Coptic angels on narrative canvases, and so think back to what I've mentioned about the refigured Coptic angels, of what I've said about narrative and storytelling in the long canvases, of fearlessness with the power of color. His interest in large, unstretched canvases dovetails with the influence of an interest in frescoes, wall painting, and art in the context of community, which was an ongoing concern with him. He was raised in the powerful world of Coptic Orthodox rituals, with all of its powerful iconography, community force, and multisensory expression with smoldering frankincense combined with mammoth African drumming and the haunting eyes of frescoed Coptic angels. The church is a site for biblical storytelling and also community continuity and family storytelling that goes back for centuries and has special valence in the face of ongoing war and subsequent diaspora. So when he came to paint, there was all of that. And there was also the influence of the Scrovegni Chapel and Giotto's influence as the great colorist of European church painting, though he was always quick to point out that his Christianity was far older than European Christianity. That's a Bearden. And so Model, this is Model Sleet's Magic Garden, and the second compound painting is called Zememesh Berhe's Magic Garden. I should have read out that title. And that's his mother's name. And so this is the Giotto Scrovegni Chapel. And if you can imagine, these blues are much, 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 much more intense in person. And this leads us to his painting, The Sardine Fisherman's Funeral. In this work, we see a profound understanding culturally arisen of the proximity of life to death and the importance of ritual and community, even if those communities are made in diaspora, to carry us across the line between life and death. Sometimes those communities are invented in art, as we see here. The painting is a pan-African fantasia that calls to mind the phrase associated with Romeo Bearden's work, the prevalence of ritual. We see the jazz funeral umbrellas, New World rituals, as West African as the recurrent bottle trees. We see the Ghanaian fantasia coffins, and let me show you some pictures of these extraordinary things in real life. These are coffins. The tradition of coffin making, this one, which began with the Ga people of southern Ghana and which continues in the present, reflected the belief that there is another form of life after death and that the revered deceased must be properly ushered into death, where they will become ancestors, far more powerful than those on earth and able to influence the living. These coffins are only seen on the day of burial and reflect sometimes the occupation but also the status of the deceased. They are referred to as custom, fantastic, or proverbial coffins, abebu adekai, made by specialized craft people. And so the proverbial is very important because they're coffins that tell little stories, made by specialized craftspeople. And they were shown in a Western context for the first time in the land and out of the context of their use in the very controversial but landmark exhibition of African art, Magicien de la Terre, at the Musée National d'Art Moderne in Paris in 1989. So that's the first time that these kinds of coffins were seen. And so back to the Sardine Fisherman's Funeral. Amongst the mourners in this painting, you see an outlined figure in the lower left corner. Here we go. Echoing an angel at the other diagonal of the painting in the corner. And this would be a ghost, an absent present. You see that he's not filled in the way that the others are. The recurrent shape of the compound gate, which we see in the center bottom there, is at last the gate between worlds, the portal through which we pass back and forth. The ritual of dying is a Pan-African hybrid here. The fabric ladder hangs over the side of the boat, but upon which premise would anyone have to climb in and out of a coffin? The Coptic angels are sentries across the top of the page, near ancestors present, guarding the community and at the ready to usher the exited body into the ancestral domain. Black life is fragile. Another outlined figure is mysterious in the side of the canvas. If you see down at the bottom towards the right, Ficre wondered aloud to me on repeated occasions why he could not paint out that sinister figure, why it persisted, why the face, which he thought of as very ugly, was so familiar, why it had to remain in the frame. 500,000 people were killed on Mengistu Haile Mariam's watch during the Red Terror of 1977 to 1978, the period in which Ficre left his country and began an extended period as a refugee. The angels ultimately have more heft and weight compositionally in the picture than this sinister figure, but the figure remains. When I first went into Ficre's studio a few weeks after he died, the life force within the space literally brought me to my knees. He was utterly present, but of course he was not present. He had left the studio tidy and ordered. As I began to take in what was there, the hundreds and hundreds of canvases, not to mention the photographs, multimedia pieces, short animated films, charcoal and pastel sketches, and much more, I saw that what he had been doing was creating an entire body of work, full and complete. I had seen every line and mark he had ever made, literally, at some point, but taking in everything together, as we have been over the last sad months, has been revelatory. He left us with his eyes on the world. He left us with an entire life's work. This painting is called Visitation, and every morning and every night I open and close my eyes to it. It allegorizes our first meeting in the State Street studio when I walk through the foster kindness door into my future. In the painting, a man and a woman meet with offerings. From the woman, scarlet red tomatoes, her own fecundity held in cupped hands at her womb. She is wearing all white, the white of the Yoruba goddess Yemaya, with her blue nearby in the background, and the white of Obatala, the creator of all human bodies. The solemn brown man humbly offers an eye on a plate. We stand inside of him and have the privilege of seeing out as he did, and that eye is also an icon, a protective evil eye that a caretaker is offering his coming family. As in so many of his paintings, he has created a spirit house. Though the pair is meeting for the first time, they are surrounded by the images of the children they will soon have, and their sons are painted as angels, for in Ficre's work there are angels everywhere in landscapes where ancestors are conjured and present. A curtain of flowers rains down over the woman's space, illuminating her. Visitation has Ficre's characteristic sense of what Emi Capalazzo called in his work tutti, the unshakable belief in beauty, in overflow, in everythingness, the bursting indelible beauty in a world where there is so much suffering and wounding and pain, as he well knew, a world in which he walked close to death from birth, ancestors by his side. And so this is, how do I make it play? I click here, no.
Go over to the right, maybe.
Oh, there we go. Thank you so much, Jennifer. This is Jason Moran's Cradle Song, and we'll listen to a little bit if you listen carefully. That's what I want you to hear. Song appears on the album Artist in Residence, which was recorded shortly after the pianist's dear and influential mother died of cancer. Cradle Song is a simple, elemental solo that sounds something like a mature student's variation on a simple piano exercise, perhaps a variation on a Chopin etude before the student has learned it well enough to play it fully fluently. Made after his mother passed away, it includes the recorded sound of intense pencil writing. That's what you hear. According to Moran, this is meant to represent his mother's writing and taking notes during his music lessons when he was a child. It's a very, very small quotidian sound. The presence of his mother's hand. It's called back into the music, called across the line between life and death. And in that sound, she is present. The sound of the writing is the second instrument in the recording. The piano solo is then a duet with the mother who was by her son's side as he learned to become a piano player. If the presence of the mother taking notes by her young son's side is what moved him forward and accompanied him as an apprentice, its sound on the recording is what enables him to make music after she has died. Art replaces the light that is lost when the day fades. The moment passes, the evanescent extraordinary makes its quicksilver. Thank you so much. Art tries to capture that which we know leaves us. As we move in and out of each other's lives, as we all must eventually leave this earth, the great artists know that shadows work always against the dying light, but always knowing that the new day brings new light, and that even the ocean, which washes away all traces on the sand, leaves us a new canvas with each wave. It's a fact. Black people in this country, and here we'll stop this, Black people in this country die more easily, at all ages, across genders, more catastrophically. Look at how our young black men die, how our middle-aged black men drop dead, how black women are ravaged. The numbers graph to poverty, but they also graph, as we know, to stresses known and invisible. How did we come here to this place, after all, not with upturned chins and bright eyes, but rather in chains across a chasm? But what did we do? We built a nation, and we built its art, nothing less. I want to conclude with Shirley Horn and her recorded version of the song, You Won't Forget Me. Horn recorded the song in 1991 when it was all but forgotten. She saw it in a rerun of a 1953 movie called Torch Song, starring Joan Crawford, wherein the song was subbed by a singer named India Adams. And I can't tell you how much, as I researched India Adams, I wanted her to be black, but she was not black. She was a white lady. Horn's recording of that song and the eponymous 1991 album it appeared on brought the singer-piano player into full flower of her comeback. I loved this song to no end when it first came out, so much so that it eventually inspired me to write a play in 1995 about a black woman artist, a dancer, facing the failure of her dancing body and the end of her life with sorrow and regret, and the cavalcade of ancestors who came to do the crucial work of taking her across the water to the other side, as we saw yesterday in Bill T. Jones's D-Man in the Waters. And let's just start this. You can listen, and this time I can do it. You may know it, but I hope there's someone here who's never heard this before, so you can have the experience of hearing it for the first time. We'll listen a minute, and then I'll say some more. Song, and if you want to confirm for yourself that Shirley Horn is a genius, you should listen to Carly Simon's version of this song. Carly Simon's a very good singer, but she sings it at a clip, unafraid of the languor that Shirley Horn so embraces, and you can see the way in which this is such a thoroughgoingly fresh interpretation of the song. Miles Davis, who you hear on this record, was a mentor to Horn in the early days of her career. She's from Washington, D.C., and studied as a child from the age of, well, four, and then at 12, she began to study piano and composition at Howard University. She received admission to Juilliard, but her family could not afford to send her. So she studied on her own and said, quote, Oscar Peterson became my Rachmaninoff, and Ahmad Jamal became my Debussy. Sneaking into the famous jazz clubs in the U Street corridor of D.C. as a minor. She formed her first jazz trio when she was 20, and Davis championed her work, loved her work, helped her get a recording contract. We're talking about 1959, and as one of the people whose work I read when I was researching more about Horn said, the extent of Davis's interest in and mentorship in her was extraordinary, but also in 1959, this person said, Miles Davis wasn't saying anything nice about anybody, but he thought that she was a genius. Her career had a detour while she raised her family in Washington and confined her playing mostly to local clubs. She reemerged, signed with Verve Records, and developed a new fan base in the late 1980s. When she recorded You Won't Forget Me, she asked Davis, who by that point had had as many lives as a cat, to play on the record. By the time the record was released in 1991, Davis was dead, and it was his last studio recording as a sideman. This recording emphasizes the always-already-ness of his ghostly sound, his horn moving over the words, You won't forget me, no matter where you are, with whom you are, you'll think of me. But the ghostliness in the performance moves the song away from a lover's lament that she will never be forgotten to a lover speaking across the line between life and death. The four main musical lines of the song are all notably delicate and spare. Horn's piano, Horn's voice, Miles's horn, and the steady drum line. That sparseness mimics spare and coded communication after long life together, the shorthand of intimate communication, old marrieds finishing each other's musical sentences, knowing what the other is thinking, stepping in with what the other needs to complete a musical thought. The drum, quite notably, is like a metronome or a ticking clock. Indeed, by the end of the song, it is even more pronounced, as though time for the couple has run out, but the clock ticks on. You Won't Forget Me and the expressive presence of the horn makes this, I think, a song about eternal love and that which remains when the bodies are no longer coterminal. You Won't Forget Me is not a wish, not a command, but rather a statement of how people remain with each other even after they have left each other. And so the black artist, in some way, spoken or not, contends with death, races against it, writes amongst its ghosts, who we call ancestors. We listen for the silences and make that art. Don't forget to feed the loas, Ishmael Reed wrote. And so by making art, we feed the ancestors, leave water and a little food at the altars we have made for them, and let them guide the work. We listen, we hasten to create. Survivors stand startled in the glaring light of loss, but bear in the light witness. The black folk poets who are our ancestors spoke true when they said, every shut eye ain't asleep, every goodbye ain't gone. Thank you very much. Thank you. So I'm very happy to have a conversation. Nell.
Yeah. I saw the show in New York, which was thrilling. And one of the things that really struck me, and I speak here as a painter, is that Vickrey is so often used unstretched canvas.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I began to touch on that. I think that that's very tied into the influence of murals and a kind of an overwriting of the murals on the streets of Mengistu and Mao and Lenin and Stalin. And I think also it spoke to what he loved in frescoes, what he saw on caves, that was a way to put the art en plein air in a certain way, or to put it in space, to take it out of the gallery space or the studio space. He resisted the gallery space, as you know, his whole life. So I think that unstretched canvas felt to him like it was work that could be on walls in a city, you know, walls in a cave, walls in a church. He was also, as far as painters who excited him, when he saw some of Kerry James Marshall's gardens paintings, some of which are unstretched, that blew his mind with excitement, because he felt like that was a contemporary painter who, even if he wasn't doing it for the same reasons, was sort of getting away with it, as it were, that it could be okay. And I think especially also in the context of things that he didn't like about the contemporary art world and what he felt was too much of an emphasis on the polished and the presentational, I think that he thought of unstretched canvas. I mean, it literally, as you know, does cost less money than stretched canvas, although you can stretch your own canvas. But he thought of it as, I think, a humbler material that said that art can exist anywhere.
I also use unstretched canvas, but I think of it more as my paper. And I think that's my former life as a writer, kind of getting there.
Yeah, he did works on paper. He did some drawing, but he wasn't an inveterate drawer. He wrote in notebooks. He was a paper person in that regard, so that's very interesting. And I think that certainly in thinking about the whole, and I haven't even begun to touch it, the whole language and graphicness and letterness and alphabetness, that there might also be a connection there as well. Yeah, thanks. Sir.
I'm interested in his early influences, childhood influences. You see that in his more contemporary paintings, and then have a second. totally unrelated. His link to West Africa and more, how that happened.
Yeah, so in his childhood influences, it's mostly those baskets that I showed, those textiles. When I say his mother was a colorist, he talked about how the flowers she planted within the compound, the way that she would whimsically, he said he'd come home from school and the house was painted all different colors inside. There'd be one wall, one wall, one wall, one wall. That she had a very, very refined sense of color. So in a sense, he grew up living in a painting in a certain kind of way. And in the artistic statement for the art school, he says something really interesting about how new the idea of the painter is. As we would understand immediately what a painter is, and how new that was for him. So there weren't painters as such in the culture who made paintings that then went up in people's walls. If you were aesthetic, you made your environment, and if you made things that we might call painting, they often had a didactic function. And so what he talks about a lot is how fundamental it is to grow up. You know, Eritrea is a very, very small country, a very fierce country, and a country that proudly fought for his independence, you know, literally during the span of his, from his birth for 30 years. So the idea that he grew up with, that if you make art, it must be of service, was something he struggled with. Because, and I think that that also explains his resistance to the gallery world, because that felt uncommunal to him. And that you had to almost make art and give it away. And that was what you are supposed to do, is always turn your talents over to the community. But of course, the community was in such violent diaspora, so the community was everywhere. You talked about West Africa, and I think that what's really interesting is the way, you know, he would talk about how when he was a child, as I said, you know, James Brown, Angela Davis, you know, all this stuff was stuff that he knew. He was number six in the family. He had one sister who came to the States and went to Hampton, and as he said, you know, came back with records and dances, you know, and so, you know, there was a way that there was, and also he was a reader, and radical black thought was not unfamiliar to him. And then that's different, of course, than West Africa and its iconography and its rituals. And that was something, I think, that he learned later on. I think it's also, when you think about 31 years, in New Haven, Connecticut, and deep friendship with Robert Ferris Thompson, who's written about his work, who was a great champion of his work, and isn't that interesting, you know, that if the people in the art school are looking for the West African as something somehow organic, that it was probably something he learned not as a student at the university, because he wasn't a student at the university till he was 40 years old, but as someone who lived in New Haven and knew how to access the resources of the university and who fed the university. So actually, Thompson wrote one of his books on the white tabletop paper in Cafe Adulis. Robert Ferris Thompson is known for what he does in New Haven is he sort of picks a restaurant for a book, and he'll just go there every night for dinner for a year until it's done. And at Cafe Adulis, I have to find out which one he wrote, but he would write, and then he'd rip off the paper, fold it up, and take it home. While eating this food. So in that regard, I think that that's where some of the magical things like bottle trees, which I bet he never saw, you know, made their way into. Because of course, if you saw a bottle tree and could paint, wouldn't you paint one, right? Yeah. Thank you for that. Yes?
I'm curious about the question that was asked to where African
colors?
Yes, in the world. I wonder how he responded to that as an artist. And I ask, because, you know, the other side of the Atlantic, the artists that Zika Shonibare, you know, whose parents were from Nigeria, and was going to school in London, he was asked the same question when he was
interesting.
And Zika Shonibare, working in what he thought was contemporary mode.
Yes.
Maybe other art school students.
Mm-hmm.
His response was to, okay, so you want to see African, and then I'm going to give it to you.
With the fabrics
and
everything.
Yeah, and that's how the artist sculptures came about.
Yes, yes.
Then on the other hand, you have Skunda Gbosha that you did mention.
Yes.
Who came to West African sculpture via negro.
Mm-hmm.
Because that was a classic African So, and I saw that he also worked in Arabic things, which was Sene Khosro, who is European. What he's known for working with this Arabic. So I'm wondering if there's a sense in which he was using both the Arabic and even the large eyes of Ethiopian art, Ethiopian Christian art, as a way to identify with his options in some ways, although not in the same way that a Ogosian or Khosro would.
Yeah.
But I wonder if those are other instances where he was actually responding to this way of locating the self in a particular cultural space.
Yeah, well, that's a very rich set of questions. Thank you. I think, first of all, what your question illustrates for me is what my dearest hope is, that you and Kobina and Salah Hassan and others will, write about this work as contemporary African art, thinking about what that is, and also paying the kind of close attention that you would, not only to origins, but also to the timeline. The timeline is crucial, and as you know, where people go in diaspora is crucial. And with the whole Ethio-Eritrean conflict, I show that painting, and he's kind of grumbling a little bit, because he didn't look at Bogosian ever before he made paintings. And the Ethiopian identity that Bogosian brought to the painting world came at a time that was very at odds with an Eritrean identity. Now we have our students and everyone's all, happy and stuff, but the generation of their parents, these were, bitter, violent, death-causing conflicts. So to identify with a Bogosian wouldn't quite be the thing, but I'm really excited about the idea of a beautifully complex contemporary history of African art that looks at, let's say, after the short century, a kind of comparative way of thinking about what Pan-African art is, and how interesting. You talk about that turn through negritude, and that's why I mentioned also Hale Woodruff, for example, and Afro Emblems, and these African American artists a generation before who were saying, "What is Africa to me?" So it becomes another layer of interesting when an East African American artist says, "What is Africa to me?" and comes at it through culture and not through the growing up. His response to the art school people was to keep making his work and to continue to explain himself. And of course, in our comparative conversations, we would sometimes say that, perhaps the blessing of coming with an African sense of self is that you haven't spent a whole life explaining yourself to white people who know nothing about your culture. So he had a bit of stamina for it, and just offered it up because he actually so profoundly wanted to share his culture, which I think is also part of what it meant to come from a small, fierce place as well. So thank you for that.
I think it
it's always mysterious in artists of any kind, you know, how they take things in and what they see out of the corner of their eyes and what they return to over and over and over again. So I would put one more thing on the table, which also relates back to your question, and that is, this is thinking about the transition from the kind of artisticness that he saw around him at the kind of intimate level, and also I wanted to mention that it, Asmara, as many of you may know, is the most intact city of Italian modernist architecture on the planet. In part because of how messed up the politics are, these extraordinary Italian buildings have remained untouched, and there's a great, terrific book about it called Africa's Secret City that I would urge you to look at. So also writ large, there are those buildings, and while I don't want to sort of say African influence, European influence, and you put them together and you get, you know, I do think it's important to try to think through how crossings are much more intimate and how colonialisms differ quite a bit from each other. And so that there could be a way that you could be a colonialized person and at the same time aesthetically take in and make something of the colonial aspects of your environment. A colonialism that is designed to keep you in your place, but as he would even sometimes say, you know, oh, the Italians, they weren't so bad compared to, you know, like, at least it wasn't, you know, I mean, there are all kinds of other, it's irreverent, so I won't say any more. But so I think influence is really mysterious, and I don't think it's one-to-one, especially not with people who make, as I think he does, really great art. I mean, I can say a few generalizing things, you know, that I think that in Benchon and in early Bearden, this whole idea of social realism and what it means to portray people in their social environments and what it means to portray working people and regular people. You think about, you know, all of Benchon and those park benches, you know, people sitting in the midst of New York City just minding about their business, regular folk, and that translates into all of those figures on the subway. Also a kind of empathy that comes out in those figures that he paints on the subway, many of whom were homeless people riding the subway back and forth and sleeping there. So there's that sort of, to see that kind of empathy translated in painting, I think, was very important. I think of Matisse as being a very black French artist. You know, and I think that the fearlessness about the drive and power of high affect color is something that I would say, not sure what he would say. And also I see in some of Matisse's dancing figures that there is a similar attention to bodily form. And then finally, you know, there are the very explicit references. So, you know, his Red Room is consciously. So he named a few paintings and we named paintings together. And I've named, along with Kijo Lee, some of the paintings after he passed away, according to what I know was how he named paintings. And so Red Room was his painting. And he wasn't thinking about Matisse's Red Room when he made it. But again, as often happens in art, you look and you say, oh, you know, that's what I did. I guess I was thinking about that. Or Zememesh Berhe's Magic Garden. You know, I mean, Bearden was so important to him. And he did love the painting Maud L. Sleet's Magic Garden. Those two paintings look nothing alike. You know, they don't have anything visually akin. But I think that the idea for the word magic to say something even more powerful about conjuration and what it means to think of the garden and the compound as being able to protect your family is something that spoke to him really powerfully. Mysterious, Eddie and then Farah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'm trying to form a question because I've never seen this before. And your framing move was to separate life from each other. So I want to
Yes, Professor Lau.
What does it mean to write about this? Mm-hmm. What are you saying about grieving and about love in this? There's an argument. Mm-hmm. It's not even an argument. There's a point that's being made about love.
Yeah, thank you for that. I'm saying that I am so grateful I have an art form with which to grieve. You know, that's really what I'm saying more than anything, that I know what to do to move through this in a certain way. I'm saying that I've realized that, you know, we all have losses that mean as much to us, right? But that what feels extraordinary to me, what makes me stand back in wonder is I think, well, yes, I lost him, but he left us this. And in this, I had a very profound understanding. You know, I've looked at art and written about art and thought about art my whole life. And what I learned that I didn't know before is that in art, we stand in the body of the person who made it and look out at the world as only they did. And as I said when we opened the gallery show, as no one who ever walked planet Earth has ever seen planet Earth. And that's what it means. That's what we can get from art. Not just pleasure or, you know, a sort of aesthetic experience. That's the profound human thing that we get when we look at art. I learned that from being in the presence of the paintings and thinking that for me in the paintings, that his hand touched those paintings, that those canvases are infused with his actual molecular presence. And so I would press my hands to the paintings for what remained of the trace of his hand, the emanation. But that even if that is something that's mine, at the same time, we talk about this when we talk about art, we talk about the artist's hand. We talk about brush strokes and marks, things that are made on the canvas. So those two things come together in a really amazing way. I think also in life, we critiqued each other's work. He was my only person who I ever showed the poems to. He was a very, 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 very astute reader of poems, and he didn't sort of break them down and put marks. He used to do this incredible, like a Ouija board thing. He would just put his hand on the poem, and he'd say, that's the problem. He'd put his finger on a spot, and he was always right. Pissed me off. Always right. I think I was done. And he'd say, you know, well, that's the problem. And that was indeed where the knot had to be untangled. And so similarly, he would invite me in the studio, wanting so badly to be done, saying, look, I was cold. I'd say, too much pattern. Or, what are you doing here? You're not done here. You're so done here, and you're not done here. And then I'd leave, and then he'd finish the painting. So in a way, the taking off the wife hat is a way that, as his wife, I was always his critic. That's love too. You know, that's love too. I think also that sentence was a way of saying, because my job now, so I thought, you know, I'm not gonna be writing and talking about these paintings for the rest of my life. You're gonna be writing about these paintings for the rest of your life. You know, what I hope will happen is that I can do some work now to make this work available. Until people thanked me for sharing it, it hadn't occurred to me that it was unusual to share it. But I thought, oh yeah, this is mine and my boys. This belongs to no one but us. We don't have to share it. But we have to share it. Because I really, 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 really believe it is important and should be seen and has something to say and can be illuminated. I'm not gonna learn Tigrinya. I want someone to tell me what's happening in those figures, those alphabet figures. I can't know all of it, and I love the idea, maybe it's the teacher in me, that other people will tell me what they see in it, and then they'll take it, and then whatever's meant to happen will happen. But that I will have done the thing that only I can do, is get it started. So that's the beginning of an answer. Yes?
Yeah.
Oh my God, Farrah. No, no, no. Excuse me.
I almost feel like you just—you said it all. I have a—I think this is a comment and not a question, but I hope you will respond.
Yes.
First of all, thank you. And you and both today very much. And as I heard you talk about these paintings, it allowed me to place them in a larger context of the life that I knew.
Mm.
And I wondered if you could talk. I mean, I thought, oh my God, these paintings are a kind of on a continuum of Fikre's artistic offerings that were sometimes paintings, but also I experienced as incredible meals that were works of art,
mm-hmm.
and extraordinary gifts from a beautiful garden that was a work of art,
mm-hmm.
or just a life, a very generous life. I think at one point you said something about the painting. You said there's too much going on here.
Mm-hmm.
That's what not that there's too much, but that there's just this abundance of color and generosity. And so I wondered if you could maybe think aloud a little bit about the paintings as part of a continuum of a life of generosity and offering and art.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you for that. You know, I didn't read it out, but there was another wonderful comment in here about how he saw his food making I am continually recontextualizing my normative experiences in early Eritrea, and one of those manifestations has been my work as a chef, where I have found myself integrating cross cultures into dishes. My cooking is how I make my living, but I have also been able to make a creative experience that in fact complements my painting philosophy. You know, so he really did, and he would sometimes, when we would fuss, he would say, the cooking, the painting, it's all the same, and I would say, it is not all the same. And you are a painter, and, you know, just because you're also really good at this other thing, like actually better than anybody who does that particular thing, because actually the food, I mean, I'm not just bragging on it, but it was before everyone said fusion this and fusion that, it was, you know, a really, sort of a fantasia Eritrean cuisine, and people would come into the restaurant space thinking they were going to go to an ethnic restaurant, and you know, but that wasn't the vibe at all. I mean, it was really about syncretization. That was his big word. And in, you know, acts large and small, he did live that life of offering, which is why I think in Visitation, the offering is so powerful, because that so fundamentally is who he was. There is an art to living, you know. There is an ethics of generosity that I think, you know, permeates, and I think also had something to do, you know. So there are at present count 800 paintings. We haven't gone through all the photographs yet. There's a lot of stuff. And so I think that also, you know, has to do with this idea of walking next to death from birth and not taking time for granted and being not in a hurry, as you know, in the way that we experienced him. My mother tells a really beautiful story about how when we went in Washington to the botanical gardens with the children, my mother was, you know, taking the children, moving along, and she'd go, where's Fikre? And he'd be many rooms back, looking at a bromeliad, very, very closely, and at first, it drove my very efficient mother crazy, but then she said, I realized that Fikre is all about process and about living in the moment. And that he knew, and I compare this to the really beautiful children's book, Frederick by Leo Lannone, where Frederick is a little mouse, the whole mouse community is harvesting for the winter, and Frederick is like, doo 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 doo, and then the cold winter comes and they run out of corn, and Frederick comes and paints word pictures for them because he's been storing stories. And so I think that way in which he was just taking it all in to put it back out again, and the way that he understood
And this is, I mean, what can be said? He understood, actually, that he didn't have all the time in the world. Somewhere he understood that. So, yes?
I think this will be our last question.
Okay, great.
I'm sorry.
Of course. Yep, yep. Please.
Thanks for the very stimulating lecture. I wanted to ask you, you know, to see whether it is possible for us to draw a connection with this multi-linguistic gift and the diverse extent of its output with the character of this composition. Again, thanks for the very rich illustrations of this work, so one gets to see a wide vista of words and begin to understand the way the personality works in the world. But I'm interested in your comment, observation about how this multi-linguistic palette, the wide
Well, I mean, your comment in itself is very interesting, and I would love to hear more about what you see as the sort of logic of languages that moves throughout the work. You talk about his travels, and what I would add to that for emphasis is to ask us to think about what's the difference between travels and being a refugee. So what is the difference with a kind of a language acquisition that comes because you walk from Eritrea to Sudan and you have to speak Arabic. You know, you've been in a colonial Italian school, so that's where your book learning comes from, and you carry that with you. You go from Italy and then to Germany, where, you know, that was a place where the particular aspects of German racism converged with needing to learn the language well enough to become a high school student in Germany. So, you know, the kind of necessity of acquiring languages because you're a refugee, I think is important to remember, and it was important for me to learn, you know. My starting point was, brother speaks all these languages. That was so cool. And then also, of course, as I don't need to tell you or any of you, that is, of course, far more matter of fact for Africans than for people in the United States to have more than one language at your disposal. So I think that I wonder if there are ways to think about the acquisition of those languages and then the later studious autodidactic attempts to acquire Chinese and French. Interest in all, you know, he had a whole bunch of books in his studio, the library in his studio. That's something else that we're going to be cataloging because it's amazing. Books on Sanskrit, which you know, was also tied into the devotion of his yogic practice. But also, he thought those letters were pretty. You know, I mean, just simply as objects. And he was fascinated in Chinese calligraphy about the, you know, that how meaning was tied to the artfulness with which you could make those characters. So I'm just kind of adding a few things to your question because I think there's really a lot to say there. So thank you for that.
We've had such a rich conversation, and so we want to thank Professor Allison.
Thank you.